번째 발표가 되겠고요. 세타랩의 전략 팀장님이신 웨스 레빗님께서 발표를 준비해 주셨습니다. User adoption of blockchain project, hype versus reality라는 주제로 말씀해 주시겠습니다. So please, come forward to the stage. 네, 여러분 박수로 환영해 주세요.
Hey. Oh, the remote for the... Oh, okay, gotcha. Hi, everyone. I'm Wes Levitt with Theta Labs. Thanks for everyone for staying this late, considering there's a typhoon coming straight for us. So I wanted to talk today about blockchain and real-world adoption, basically the hype of the space versus the reality of it. Obviously, we wouldn't be here if we didn't think there was a lot of potential with blockchain, but I want to take a more sober look at where we stand relative to where the hype has gotten to us. So first, just for some context, I wanted to start with some high-level numbers. About 1.5 transactions are completed on all blockchains per day. That's made up of about 800 individual blockchains and about another 1,000 crypto tokens built on top of those. A little less than $4 billion of venture capital has entered the space, and the current market cap fluctuates around $200 billion, down from about $830 billion at its peak in January. So those all sound like very impressive numbers, and if you didn't know any better, you would assume that means that every mainstream user is already using their favorite dApp and using blockchain. But unfortunately, that's not really the case. The vast majority of blockchain usage is made for speculative purposes. For example, here, if you look at the last 12 months of active addresses for both Bitcoin and Ethereum, I've laid the price over each of these graphs, and you can see it pretty much tracks one-to-one. As soon as the price drops, you see the active addresses drop commensurate with that, and that's been true pretty much since the early days of both blockchains. Now, you may think, okay, well, the underlying blockchains are just building blocks, but it's the decentralized apps or the dApps where you're really seeing user adoption. Unfortunately, that's really not the case either. So the makeup of dApps, according to Dapp Radar, is the majority are still decentralized exchanges, meaning, once again, it's trading and speculation. Now, if you look over here, these first top five are the five most popular dApps in existence. With IDEX, a decentralized exchange, being number one with about 2,000 users. Now, compared to Kakao Games with 10 million daily active users, Kakao Talk with 50 million, WeChat, Facebook with 1 billion per day, you can see that we're not just a little bit away from mainstream adoption, we're four orders of magnitude away from mainstream dApps. So there's a long way to go. Now, a lot of projects, since the actual blockchains and dApps aren't being used that frequently, we'll use corporate partnerships as a proxy, or at least show progress toward it. But unfortunately, a lot of corporate partnerships are also pilot programs, proof of concepts, very early stages. At the Theta Network on my project, it's unfortunately the same way. We have some great partnerships with Samsung VR and a couple Korean firms that we'd like to, that we'll be talking about soon. But the reality is it's very, very early stages and not nearly at the level of mainstream adoption that we'd like to be at. And really, that's the good ones. There's been many cases where, sadly, they are almost falsified. You can see some examples. I won't spend too much time picking on other guys, but you know, IOTA announcing a partnership with Microsoft when in reality they're just an Azure customer, or Monaco announcing a partnership with Visa when in reality it was pending and never happened. This race to get credibility through claiming adoption through corporate partners is just going to cause more of a backlash in the end when people stop believing the reality of these. Now, I want to stop for a second because while adoption is great and we all want to see mainstream users of blockchains, I don't want to say that that's the end-all be-all, because there's a lot of projects that are doing very important things, building infrastructure layers for blockchain that are 1, 3, 5-year projects that are not meant for, you know, your typical user to use tomorrow. It's the building blocks for the future. And so just some examples, interoperability between blockchains, Polkadot, Cosmos Hub, a lot of great projects working on that. Scalability is, of course, an issue for all blockchains. So layer two solutions like Lightning Network and Raiden are very important. And stable coins, which will make enterprise adoption that much easier without the price volatility of most tokens. like Maker using a collateralized stablecoin, Basis using a algorithmic stablecoin, all very great. But that said, the price and the media hype isn't because of long-term projects like these, it's because of projects promising to change the world tomorrow. And I think that's really starting to catch up with where we are. So this is not news to most people in the room, so I won't belabor this point for too long, but we all know that since January, the prices of virtually, if not all, crypto assets have suffered greatly. And while that's true of everything, including Bitcoin, it's been particularly pronounced in every other token, or so-called altcoins. And for the vast majority of those, it's because, unlike an infrastructure underlying blockchain like Bitcoin or Ethereum, these are user-focused dapps, where they're issuing a token that is only useful if it's being used by many active users. And when you don't see this rate of adoption for these dapps or these crypto tokens, you're going to see a direct correlation with their price taking a beating, and that's just going to be a fact of life. More on the point of the altcoin suffering the worst of this, the Bitcoin dominance ratio, which is essentially total Bitcoin market capitalization divided by total crypto market capitalization, is starting to increase back to where it was in early 2017 and is up to 53%. A lot of people have argued that's because Bitcoin as a store of value is the only one that has actually proved out its use case to a large degree to this point. Like I said, the press are also starting to catch up on this. I will say that our experience on the Theta team with Korean journalists and press has been a lot more positive because we found the press tends to take a more longer-term view, and even as prices go down, they're thinking more about the underlying technology and still seeing why that's a great thing. But I can tell you from my experience with a lot of United States journalists, they are really turning the narrative against blockchain and crypto assets at this point. And I've been told directly by many of them that they've been told a lot of promises, and they were told that this technology was going to change the world very quickly and that their grandma would be using all these dapps. And now that it's not starting to happen, there's a real backlash against it. The top headline here, I think, really exemplifies what I'm talking about, that this dapp usage versus valuations is just such an incredibly striking discrepancy when you see, you know, a dApp is worth several hundred million dollars and it's got 50 daily active users. It's unprecedented, the multiple you would need on a per user basis to justify that valuation. So now that I've gotten all the negativity out of the way, I don't want to spare my own project. So at the Theta Network, we have had a lot of issues with adoption as well as we start moving past our testnet phase and into the mainnet launch. And the reality is it's because, you know, we have a decent understanding of blockchain by learning about this ourselves, going to conferences, working on a lot of our own projects. And I think we have a tendency to think that if we just push out this product to your average everyday user, that they're going to feel the same and they're just going to jump right in. And the reality is most of these systems and these crypto economic models are very complicated. And it's not going to be easier for most users to jump into them. So that's been the thing that we have really tried to turn our focus to, is hyper-focused on user adoption and what we can do to solve that. So very quick background, what Theta is a decentralized video delivery network. What we're creating is a peer-to-peer mesh streaming network that allows users to share video with other users in the area, either using excess bandwidth or excess computing resources to share videos, particularly live streaming, video demand, and in return for that, they can earn token rewards as their incentive to share. So we're not competing with a YouTube or a Twitch, we're infrastructure that helps power those, like a content delivery network. So, you know, of course, the first thing a user is gonna think is they're used to a very easy video experience. They log on to YouTube, they just click the video you want, and you have it right there. So if you try to introduce a token and say a user has to adopt this just to get what they're already used to getting, it's a very, very strong friction point, and it makes adoption very difficult. So to start with, the first point that we try to focus on is make sure that the user experience is the number one driver here. So our goal, and we may not reach it completely, but we try to get as close as we can to having it no more complicated than your average experience going to a video site. Be a little difficult to get quite there, but you know, as soon as you teach them exactly how a token can be spent in other ways and has value, then we think that should be almost the only thing they have to understand beyond the current system. They don't need to, or they shouldn't need to know all about the intricacies and technical details of blockchain in order to use it, any more than, I don't know a lot about satellite architecture, but it doesn't stop me from using GPS. And we think that's the way it should be with blockchain as well for your average user. The second thing is, because we are an infrastructure layer and looking to partner with other video platforms rather than compete with them, we think that creates a much easier entry point for us to go in. Because rather than going from a cold start, which a lot of brand new models, economic models are dealing with, we're able to have a somewhat familiar experience to a user when they go on to use a video platform powered by the Theta blockchain for the first time. The third point is that rather than try to disrupt content delivery networks all at once in one go from the day one, what we're doing is augmenting and supplementing the existing system. So right now when you go on YouTube and you watch a video, it's delivered by Akamai or Amazon Web Services, some type of centralized content delivery network. In a lot of ways, cases that's inefficient, but there's a lot of things that centralized content delivery networks do very well too. And we recognize that, and we know that our peer-to-peer network can do some things better. But some things are better done in a centralized manner. That's just the reality of at least our specific use case. So our value proposition to a video platform that we asked to adopt the Theta protocol is that we're going to work alongside your existing systems, and where we can be more efficient by distributing video in a peer-to-peer manner, we'll do so. When not, you'll just default back to your current system. So rather than forcing a video platform to take a chance on bleeding edge and, you know, frankly, like most blockchain projects, relatively unproven technology, that's a very difficult sell to ask them to adopt that and risk their user experience. When we can say that they can adopt our protocol alongside it, it makes them much more comfortable to know that they're not going to hurt their end user experience. And we think that's going to be a key point for adoption. The last point is leveraging existing video platforms' user bases, which again goes back to the cold start problem. It's very difficult to build up a large user base and get that inflection point where you have enough users to have a strong peer-to-peer or decentralized system when you're starting from zero. And especially in a case like video delivery or video platforms, they tend to be quite concentrated already. So it's even more difficult to take on, say, a YouTube from a decentralized standpoint. So our thought process is to start by leveraging the user bases of video platforms already and introduce the Theta blockchain alongside it so that users are benefiting from it and learning about it before they even realize the underlying blockchain technology if they're not familiar with it. So a couple quick examples. Like I said, we're doing a proof of concept with Samsung VR. It is early stages, but we've been working with them since March, and in about 2 or 3 weeks we're going to be releasing a public demo on Samsung VR's website where any user that goes on to watch their VR content will have that shared with their peers among them and delivered from peers in their area. The other key point for us right now is the parent company of Theta Labs, which is Sliver TV. It's an esports streaming site. It streams popular streamers for games like Battleground or League of Legends or Fortnite and Counter-Strike. And it hit 7 million visits in July. So it's a really important sandbox for us to implement the Theta protocol. And allow all those users to start interacting with it and understanding the benefits, even if they don't fully understand why they're benefiting from this underlying blockchain technology. So a little more about that. When we launched our testnet in June, one of the critical aspects of that release is we also implemented a test channel on Sliver TV, where all content is powered on the back end by the Theta mesh streaming protocol. And so what that means is, any user that logs onto the channel without any kind of client download or any kind of browser extension download, they immediately begin sharing bandwidth with their peers, and if they have peers available, pulling the streams from them instead of a centralized CDN. In the first 4 weeks, we had more than 300,000 users that were sharing bandwidth on this and interacting with the Theta testnet blockchain. And the reality is the majority of them may not even understood what that meant. And we're okay with that. We don't think we would have 300,000 users or anything close to that if all of them were required to download a specific Theta wallet, download a Theta client to run a full node and manage private keys. The vast majority of users are not ready for that yet. So the way we see it is we can use this as a shortcut to getting users to benefit from blockchain technology and along the way educating them. Because as they earn token rewards and are interested more in why this system works and why they're benefiting from it, that's a teachable moment where we can slowly show them about the underlying technology. And that just makes adoption that much easier for the next platform and the next user. So just to summarize, some key takeaways I want to leave the audience with is that today, blockchain usage, at least by the transactions and by the numbers, is still primarily speculative. And dApp usage is still quite small compared to the centralized mainstream apps. And because of that, price volatility, like we've always seen, but especially in the last 12 months, is going to be a fact of life until the great promise of blockchain technology actually catches up with the level of adoption for day-to-day users. To get to that level of mainstream adoption, we think that we need to meet them halfway. So instead of making things more complicated to impress other blockchain projects or coming up with fancy new ways of describing things, we need to make it as easy as possible for people to understand, to stop gatekeeping for the space and try to make it more welcoming to someone who is starting from zero. They may not understand much of blockchain at all. So we want to make the experience very easy to use. We want to focus on user experience and abstract away the parts that are not necessarily to benefit for the average user. And the last thing I want to just say is to remember that patience is a virtue, because there's a lot of people that are starting to get frustrated with the pace of technology and development of blockchain, but it's still very, very early. And even though it can be frustrating after you get so excited about it, I would say do not get discouraged. Don't be discouraged to take on your own project, because while it will take some time, even if all goes well, progress is being made. And if we take more of a 3 to 5 year time horizon instead of worrying about what happens in the next 6 months, I think we'll all be happier for it. Thank you.